Hello again, Gary Stearman with another edition of Prophecy in the News. We have a very special guest today, the author of this New York Times bestseller book called The Harbinger. He's Jonathan Cahn. You've probably heard about him. Well, today you're going to get to meet him. Jonathan Cahn, welcome to the studios of Prophecy in the News. Good to have you here.
Thank you, Gary. Really great to be here.
Now, you come to us from New York.
Yeah, New York, New Jersey.
And you are, I've seen in print, and by the way, we're meeting him for the first time together today. So let's just talk to him and find out about Jonathan Cahn. Mm-hmm. You come from New York. Yeah. You're a Messianic rabbi.
That's right.
And you have quite a testimony. Let's start with Jonathan Cahn and how you came to be a Christian, because I'm really interested in that.
Well, you know, I was raised in the synagogue, went to synagogue every week. And when I was about 8 years old, I questioned the whole thing, because I heard all about how God, the God of Israel, moved in the lives of his people, spoke, did miracles, but I never saw that in the synagogue. I never saw people living it. I never saw, the rabbi never got up and said, hey, the Lord spoke to me today or moved in my life. So one day when I questioned that, that was it. It kind of all fell apart. I became an atheist when I was 8 years old.
Wow.
And so I said, that was for a little while. And then about when I was about 12, I started questioning atheism. I said, this atheism doesn't work. There's got to be a reason. There's got to be a purpose. It doesn't work. So I started seeking. I started reading everything I could, from science to religion to the occult to Nostradamus to UFOs to Chariot of the Gods, all those books. And one day, I picked up a book that I thought was like a UFO book. I thought it was a Chariot of the Gods book. Mm-hmm. It turned out to be The Late Great Planet Earth by Hal Lindsey.
Wow.
It was written that year. They put the same lettering, so it looked like those books. And that got me. So kind of God got me through the back door, you know, from being an atheist to now being open to that. And so I'm reading about Jesus. Well, I've read about Jesus in the UFO books and all the occult thing. Everybody talks about Jesus. I said, okay. And so it was all about the prophecies coming true about Israel coming back, last days, end times. So I started saying, wow. Started getting into it. I started telling my friends about it. And I didn't know the Lord, but I was winning my friends to the Lord. People were coming to the Lord because I was telling them about it, but I didn't know the Lord. So as time went on, it kind of narrowed down from, okay, the Bible, Nostradamus, it's just the Bible, then the Bible, and then I'm reading, I only had the Hebrew scripture, so I'm reading that and reading all about the Messiah, who the Jewish Messiah was born in Bethlehem, had to die for our sins. I thought that was Catholic, and I'm reading it in our Bible. So more and more, I'm believing that he is the Messiah. And the final thing was, though, I didn't want to live it, because I realized, wait a minute, you can't just be telling people about this. It's going to be about you. Where are you? If he comes again, where are you going to be? So I didn't. The thing is, I knew I had to get right with God, but I thought that if you follow God, you give up your life, you join a monastery, and that's pretty much it. So I said, Lord, let me make a deal with you. And the deal is, if you give me a long life, I will accept you when I'm on my deathbed and about to die. So that was my deal. Soon after making that deal, I was almost killed. The first time was a car accident. It was a miracle that we didn't get destroyed. The second time, I was in a little Ford Pinto, and I'm about 19 years old, and I'm crossing, going to a train track at night, dangerous track. People have been killed there. I'm going to the track, but the people across on the other side are going with the lights going on. So I said, well, maybe the light's broken. So I go up to the track and I look. And I see a light, and it doesn't look like it's moving because it's the train coming head on. I was right on the track.
Uh-huh.
So I said, well, you know what? I didn't realize it, though, still. I said, well, maybe back up a little bit, but now there are headlights in back of me. So I backed up just about a foot or two, but I was still right in the path of the train. So
wow.
I'm waiting for the train to come. The train comes. It plows into the Ford Pinto. It becomes like aluminum foil in the wind. And the only thing I could do at that moment is I just called out to God. So I called out to God. And the car was demolished, and I didn't get a scratch. So I said, Lord, I said, okay, that was good. That was close. That was strike two, right? I get one more strike, I'm out. So I thought I was going to get, I literally thought I was, if I didn't come to the Lord, I was going to get killed. So I said, Lord, can we renegotiate the deal that we made, that I made? And so I said, all right, Lord, I said, let's change it. I will accept you, not on my deathbed, I'll accept you when I'm 20. On my 20th birthday, then I'll accept you. Don't kill me up to that time. So when the time came, on my 20th birthday, it was like a contract that ran out. I was afraid I was going to get killed. So I knew I was right, but that if it wasn't for that train, I don't think it ever would happen. So I, on my 20th birthday, said, all right, Lord, I said, I don't know how to do this. Nobody was leading me, really. And so I just said, okay, I know in the Bible there are mountains. So I found a mountain. I drove up the mountain, got to the top. It was at night. I kneeled down on this rock, and I said, okay, Lord, here I am. I don't know what I'm doing, but here I am. I'm yours. Come into my life. And that's how it began. It was through a locomotive train. Without that train, I don't think I would have known the Lord.
Now, you said early on, and I think this is an important point, you said that where you came from, you didn't hear your religious leaders receiving the word from God.
Mm-hmm.
God didn't talk to mm-hmm. those people, yet he obviously began to talk to you.
Yeah, I mean, it says, you know, he said to our people, says, you know, seek me and you'll find me when you search with all your heart.
Yeah.
And I was seeking. I didn't realize it quite, but I, you know, and I was, you know, in high school, I was known as the atheist who argued with everybody. So, you know, God looks to the least likely people and said, you know, hey, I can do something here because you're so least likely that I can use you. So I think that's what happened. But I never saw that in the synagogue. It was you know, rituals, like it's religion. I understand all that, but it wasn't the presence of the Lord.
Now we're going to lead up to the Harbinger, but one more question.
Sure.
After you became a Christian, apparently the Lord led you into a teaching position of some sort. You got into the Word, and you were led to teach the Word.
Yeah, when I came to the Lord, I was in college, and I was studying history. And then when I graduated college, I said, okay, what do I do? Do I go on now with graduate work and all that? And the Lord really interrupted my life and said, and really led me that was going to be in full-time ministry for the gospel. So I started seeking, you know, Lord, what do you want me to do? I looked for Jews for Jesus, I looked for other things, but it didn't seem that was the right thing. And so I said, Lord, give me a job you would do. So he had me working with disabled children. And I worked with disabled children for several years to learn to be humble in the Lord and to serve and minister. Meanwhile, people asked me to lead a Bible study. So I said, all right, I'll do that. Bible study started growing and growing. And then they asked me to help start a Messianic congregation. Mm-hmm. So I said, all right, I'll help for a time, but I'm going to have to leave because God called me into a ministry. So one day I'll have to leave. Well, what happened is after a few years, the guy who was leading it as an outreach left, and they said, if you don't accept this, we close it down, which was the congregation was called Beth Israel, or now Beth Israel and the Jerusalem Center. So I said, yes. I said, Lord, if you want me to do this, I know I'm not supposed to give you fleeces, but I'm giving you six fleeces to do by the end of the month. And so by the end of the month, he did everything I asked. So I said, all right, Lord. So they opened it up, and it was like about 30 people. It's multiplied and multiplied. It's about, you know, it's hundreds of people now.
So it's right outside New York City. You have had the opportunity to lead a lot of people to Christ who might not have been led to Christ any other way. And that's a terrific testimony. Let's fast forward, because you wrote a book. It's called The Harbinger. And by the way, The Harbinger has been on the New York Times bestseller list. It just took off.
Yeah,
and
the first week.
And this book, for those of you who are not familiar with it, deals with a passage in the book of Isaiah chapter 9, and it talks about the past. Isaiah wrote that prophecy in Isaiah 9 about mm-hmm. national Israel,
mm-hmm. absolutely,
which had sinned grievously
absolutely.
At that point. And God said to national Israel, look, you have turned away from me, and this is what's going to happen to you.
Mm-hmm.
And Israel did not hear the message. Mm-hmm. They were very, very proud.
Yes.
And ultimately, it led to their downfall in the Assyrian captivity.
Mm-hmm.
And so, mm-hmm. ordinarily, when people read the Bible, Isaiah 9, 9, and 10, mm-hmm. that's what they think of, the
right.
Assyrian captivity. But
right.
but the Lord
right.
spoke to you mm-hmm. about this and gave you, what can I say, a vision about this particular portion of Scripture.
Yeah, Isaiah, and it's clear in the Harbinger, Isaiah spoke it to Israel, and that's what the Harbinger says. That's not the issue. Is very clear that that's what he did. However, this is what has to do with America. The Harbinger is about is subtitled "The Ancient Mystery That Holds the Secret of America's Future," and it's about this 2,500-year-old this scripture and this mystery that lies behind everything from 9/11. To the war on terror, to the collapse of the American economy, specifically that it actually foretells the words of American leaders, the actions of American leaders, even going to dates from the stock market crash, and it kind of a really amazing things. But the thing is, and here's the dynamic. The dynamic is that God of Israel is still God today. He's still in charge. And so there are patterns when a nation is under judgment. America is now the nation that has in many ways known God, been founded on his principles, but is now rapidly turning away from God. Rapidly. And
yes.
And so and we all, as believers, I don't know any believer who's I mean honest about this, who doesn't sense this. And so what it's saying is that now what happened to ancient Israel is now reappearing, is replaying now in America as signs. Not that Isaiah was saying, oh, America. It's that the same God is now using the same pattern and these same harbingers. A harbinger is a prophetic sign or a warning or a foreshadow. There were 9 harbingers that are identified appeared in the last days of ancient Israel before its destruction, warning them. Those same 9 harbingers are now reappearing on American soil, specifically some in New York City, some in Washington, D.C. Some involve leaders, some involve the highest leaders of the land, even the president. Some involve ceremonies, as is kind of an eerie prophetic reenactment that are warnings to a nation in danger of judgment. And the thing is that this nation is now America.
Now, you're not calling the United States Israel.
No. In fact, I mean, some people kind of misinterpreted this. First of all, the replacement theology, that's what replacement theology is. You know, or saying that God's finished with Israel. That has nothing to do with the harbinger. Right. It never says that. I'm Jewish. I'm of the tribe of Levi. I'm the house of Aaron. I'm not going to replace myself. You know, I don't want to be out of a job. So I've always come against replacement theology, always. They misinterpreted what, had nothing to do with that whatsoever. It's saying that the United States is now replaying these final stages of what happened in ancient Israel is now manifesting here to America.
Now, let me read Isaiah chapter 9, verse 10. The bricks are fallen down, but we will build with hewn stones. The sycamores are cut down, but we will change them into cedars. Now, kind of innocuous.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and obscure.
Obscure, to say the least.
Yeah.
But to you and to me, it talks about the destruction of ancient Israel because they wouldn't listen to God. God said, I'm going to send an enemy, and he did.
Mm-hmm.
And in 722 BC, the Assyrians came and
yes.
wiped out the
yes.
10 northern tribes.
Yes.
It was a terrible, terrible day. And it happened because Israel forgot God.
Yes.
You are looking at that.
Mm-hmm.
You're coming
yes.
now into the 21st century mm-hmm. and saying America has forgotten God,
mm-hmm.
and the same thing could happen to us. And astoundingly, and by the way, this is astounding. When you read the book, you will be amazed. There are symbols that are as plain as day concerning the event that we now know as 9/11.
Yes, yeah. The pattern, the progression is that Israel, as it defied God, he sent prophets to them, he warned them, but they wouldn't turn back. So finally he allows something to happen. That is a biblical pattern of judgment. That same pattern, this first one, or this first harbinger, actually happens with Judah too. There's an initial strike. This is the first harbinger, is the breach. He allows the nation's hedge of protection to be removed temporarily. This is years before the destruction, but it's a sign of what's coming if they don't turn back. So he allows an enemy to make a strike into the land. Those are the Assyrians. It's temporary. It's contained. It's in 732 BC. It is traumatic. It's to wake up the nation, because at this point, nothing is going to reach them but something of this magnitude. But they, instead of waking up, instead of repenting, they come back to God with a vow of defiance. And that's Isaiah 9:10. That's the significance. They say, God, you're not going to humble us. You know, in fact, we're going to come back stronger against you. The bricks may have fallen, I'm not paraphrasing, in this attack, but we're going to take these large stones and rebuild even stronger to show you we're not turning back. And the sycamores have been struck down, but we're going to take this stronger tree, the cedar, planted right in the place. This is going to be an act of defiance. So we're telling you, God, we're not going to be humbled. We're going to come back stronger than ever against you. And now the eerie thing is, America has done, is doing the exact same thing, and those harbingers are manifesting here and now.
Now, we're going to talk in more detail in just a moment, but first, I want to tell you how to get this book, The Harbinger. If you haven't gotten it, we have it here at Prophecy in the News. And the book is $16.95. We're offering with it a 2-hour DVD, which, by the way, is excellently produced. It's a wonderful DVD. It has clarity. It has superimposed scriptures, and it has information that will help you to understand what really is kind of a complex idea. It's a simple idea, and yet it has to be developed. The Harbinger, $16.95. The DVD would be $29.95 ordinarily. That comes to about $47, but we're going to sell both of them to you for only $42.95. If you just call 1-800-475-1111 and ask for The Harbinger package. Jonathan Cahn's book, The Harbinger, and this videotape. So I'm an old-fashioned kind of a guy. DVD. It's called the Isaiah 9:10 Judgment. Both of them together for $42.95. Just ask for The Harbinger package. And now,
I'll just tell you, there are two DVDs on that, just so people know. They're getting 2 hours. And it's very powerful. WND, WorldNet Daily did it. And that is the actual documentary. It became the number one faith video in the country, too, as well. While The Harbinger has a story around it, so both are different.
Now, back to some detail. And I'd like to begin with the fact that you wrote a book at all. I have heard others say that you really didn't ever set out to write a book. That is, it was not your purpose in life to be an author. But somehow the Lord spoke to you, and out of this came The Harbinger. How did that happen?
Well, we live near 9/11. I mean, you know, we're in northern Jersey, so we could see it happen as it happened. My wife, the one who's my wife now, who I was courting at the time, was supposed to be there. She had an appointment to be at the building at the time of the destruction. Wow. But her schedule was changed at the last minute. So I'm pondering this, and I'm praying at that time. And I'm led to write to that Isaiah 9 and Isaiah 10, this section of Israel when it was given its warning in its last days, the first strike, the first warning. And so I'm praying about it. And then, a while later, I'm standing at the corner of Ground Zero and I'm noticing an object. My attention is drawn to this object. I don't know why. And it's I'm being led to follow this thing. And as I start looking into this object, it leads to the next one. It's the first puzzle piece of this mystery that keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger until it involves everything and becomes the first part of The Harbinger, what would become The Harbinger. There's a whole second part that's in the book. But then I share this to the congregation, and people reacted. They were stunned, and they said, this word has to get out. So that's always been the nature when people have heard it. So I didn't do anything for a while, but then I was led to commit it into book form to get the word out, that this word has to go out. And so I did that, and when I finished it, I was led to rewrite the whole thing, to do it in a narrative to reach more people, to make it easy, because there are deep things in it, to get more people to be able to hear it, know it. And so I put it in the form where there's a figure called the prophet, and there's nine seals, but 90% of it is the revelations of the Harbinger, are nonfiction, but in this thing. So I did it, and I finished it, and that was the first book I ever wrote. It's the only book I've written. And then they told me, 2 weeks after, because it comes on a delay, that first week it became the New York Times bestseller. Came off. Yeah.
And of course, the book is sort of set as a question and answer drama, in which you have a conversation between two people. It's very readable, by the way. Now, let's get to the interesting part. To me, the interesting part is that, and I go back to this two DVD set. Here you have actual quotes by the leaders of the United States of America in the Senate, other places, who quoted Isaiah 9:10. Astounding.
Yes.
First of all, when does a senator go around quoting scripture? And secondly, why did they choose that scripture? Because it is so meaningful.
Yeah. Everything, what's the key is that Isaiah 9:10 is like a decoder of all the harbingers. And each thing in it has been fulfilled, like step by step, precise, exact, eerily. Nobody's trying to. There's this principle that nobody's trying to put this together. It just happens. Whether it's the sycamore, the sign of the sycamore, or the stone, or everything just happens. And so this one is this in the book. It's the eighth and ninth harbinger. Is the vow itself, the fact that after the strike comes, and the strike, and we just to identify it with America, the protection of America is allowed. 9/11, there is the strike, it's the breach, this enemy comes in, it's temporary, but it's a shake-up call, wake-up call. America doesn't turn back to God. If anything, we've gone farther away from God since 9/11. People were saying, God bless America, God bless America, but it didn't happen. And so then it's like America's been replaying everything from ancient Israel. And so the vow itself, the harbinger, is that the vow would have to be spoken by a leader of the nation, because back then it had to be the leaders who said the bricks have fallen. It wouldn't have done anything if it was someone else, because it is setting the course of the nation, representing the nation. So what American leader in their right mind is going to pronounce this judgment, identify America, that's what it's doing, as the nation under judgment in defiance of God, linking it all to 9/11. That's what would have to happen in the capital city, which happened in ancient Israel. So on the very day after 9/11, the very day America is going to give its response to this calamity, the government, the Congress gathers on Capitol Hill, Senate, joint session of Congress. One man is appointed to give the response of the nation. So very significant. And that's Tom Daschle. He's the Senate Majority Leader. He gets up to the Senate, he gets up on the floor, and he gives the whole response of America. And at the very end, the pinnacle, he says, there is a word from Isaiah that I think speaks to all of us at times like this. And then out of his mouth from the Senate floor comes, the bricks have fallen, but we will replace them. We will rebuild with this dressed stone. And he speaks of the tree struck down. And he speaks of the, we'll replace everything they said. He doesn't know what he's doing. Out of 30,000 verses, he chooses, or his script writers choose, they don't even know this is a verse of judgment. And he does it right after 9/11. He doesn't even know about the strike that it parallels all this. He doesn't know about the sycamore tree. It's all going to happen. And it's like Caiaphas. I mean, and I'm not saying anything personally about the man, but Caiaphas wasn't a prophet, but he spoke prophetically when he said one man has to die for the nation. Yeah. It says because of his office. Well, Daschle represented, his office represents America. He represented the Senate and America. So he says it, and he speaks about this tree. He doesn't realize there is an actual tree, that all these harbingers, he speaks about the stone, which is another harbinger. He doesn't know it's actually going to happen. And then he says, this is what we will do, America. This is what we will do. What's he saying? He's saying, we're going to do Isaiah 9:10, and which means we're going to defy God on the day after 9/11.
Yeah, and you know, Isaiah 9:10 is not an act on leadership. It's not an act of submission. It's an act of defiance.
Yes.
That is to say, it's like talking to God and saying, okay, you let this happen, we're going to be stronger than ever. We're going to build back with even stronger building materials than before.
And which is exactly, and the interesting thing is, it's like prophetic in this way too. It's exactly what America does. I mean, because America's, we're going to come back. I mean, one of the harbinger, I mean, you know, they said that we're going to rebuild, and all the commentators, they're saying we're going to rebuild stronger, bigger than ever, because the big stone. And so what happens at ground zero? The leaders vow again and again and again, we're going to rebuild, and not just we're going to rebuild, we're going to build stronger. This tower is going to be higher than the one before. No matter what we do, it's going to be higher, stronger. They're doing everything. If you look at the commentaries, Kyle and Delitzsch and other commentaries, it's eerie because they're depicting what exactly has been taking place in America.
Yes. It happened before. It can happen again. And the Lord, I think, always, the Lord is a loving God, by the way. And he's not going to strike you down without some kind of admonition to get your attention, to let you have the opportunity to turn back to him in repentance. And I think we're in that stage right now.
Yeah.
We, as a nation, we could turn back.
We could. I mean, there are people who say it's hopeless, and you look at the way things are going. Yeah. It doesn't look like it. However, The Harbinger is ultimately a book of hope. It's giving an answer at the end because it's presenting all these things, and people read it and they say, okay, I'm scared or I'm shaken. What do we do? It is. There is a call for believers. There is a call for the nation, and there is hope. And you know, they say, oh, there's going to be judgment or revival. There can also be both. Sometimes, I mean, never. I don't know in your lifetime or my lifetime. I never saw such a turning, a potential turning to the Lord. It was potential after 9/11. People were flocking to the churches.
Yes.
You talk about God. Everybody listened at that time. It was an amazing thing, and that's like a shadow of what can happen. So the point of the Harbingers and the Harbinger book is for that purpose. It's to call for hope, for salvation, for redemption, for revival, and for repentance as well.
And another Senator John Edwards, is shown on this 2-DVD set, also quoting Isaiah 9:10. What are the odds?
30,001 times 30,001, because it's not once. The same thing on the anniversary of 9/11, on the actual anniversary.
Well, I have here the Harbinger package, and we always like to put things together in packages. This DVD set is superbly produced, and it has quotes by the leaders of the United States. It has beautiful, beautiful pictures of, for example, of the sycamore and the sycamore statue that replaced the broken tree. And it really shows you step by step what's going on and takes you back to Scripture. It is called the Isaiah 9:10 Judgment. Ordinarily, this would be $29.95. The book, $16.95. But we're going to give them both to you for a single price of $42.95. Just ask for the Harbinger package when you call 1-800-475-1111. I guarantee you a good read and a good video experience. And, well, you've been watching, Jonathan. You've got some idea of what you're going to hear. Jonathan, we could talk for another half hour. We've got about 3 minutes left.
Okay.
If you could take a minute or two, what's the most important, or what's the kernel of the message that you'd like to lay out before the people that are watching right now?
I can do it in one word: return. God's call. There are many mysteries that go towards all this one word: return. God is calling America to return from what it has fallen from, its foundation. God is calling believers to return to their first love, because we're part of this. Yeah. And that's also the heart of it. He says, if my people, that was also to Israel. However, the point is that it's not just about what is Israel, what is America going to do, and it's us and them. No, it's that we're the light. If we were being the light, it wouldn't be as it is now. We're the salt. If we were being the salt, it wouldn't be as rotten as it is now. Yeah. We are part of, a revival begins with us. It begins with us living the life we're to live. Being the light we're supposed to be. But revival begins with God's people, if my people. So the ultimate thing is if, you know, that's the ultimate thing, and my people. So that is the thing. It is time, it is late, and it is time that we have to live as we have been called to live, as the people of God.
You know, as we study prophecy, we know that perilous times are coming. The Apostle Paul said this, in the last days, perilous times shall come. I think they're here.
Yes.
And getting more perilous all the time. But we are not without hope. We have the blessed hope. And any of us at any time can come back and to the Lord and just say, Father, I know I'm a sinner. I have battled all my life with this idea of becoming a Christian, and part of me says I don't want to, and part of me says I do, but you can come to Christ and say, I'm a sinner. I know I'm a sinner. I need to be saved. Save me for the sake of the Lord Jesus Christ and his mission. And he will. He'll take you unto himself. And if you want to add to that idea.
One thing. Yeah. When people read it, someone said, well, how can I be saved? Where do we go? Do we go to the hills? Do we buy this? You know, do we buy guns and all that? In Hebrew, the word for safety, Yasha, becomes Yeshua. And the word Yeshua is the real name of Jesus. Mm. So God is salvation also means God is safety. There's one safety. There's one safe place. And that is Yeshua. That is Jesus. And it's not about where you are. It's being in the will of God. So this is a message to believers or unbelievers or saved and unsaved. Get into the will of God. Get into Yeshua, Jesus. Get your whole life there. And that is the safest thing. He is a refuge. And you don't have to fear the future. Just make sure you're right in him who is safety.
Amen. Couldn't have said it better myself. It's been most enjoyable for me, and I know for you, to spend a little time with Messianic Rabbi Jonathan Cahn. And by the way, we're not finished. We're going to do another interview with Jonathan, because we've just barely scratched the surface of what he has to say. We're very serious here at Prophecy in the News about studying Bible prophecy, about studying Israel in the latter days and the signs of things to come. And you know, they are quickening. Things are happening very rapidly. You don't have much time. Jonathan, 10 seconds or so, a word to our viewers.
Trust in the Lord with all your heart. He's going to lead you. He'll protect you. And be right with him. He'll take care of you.
Amen. Couldn't have said it better myself. And this is Gary Stearman. Have a great day in the Lord and keep looking up.
Prophecy in the News is a viewer-supported ministry sponsored by our many friends across America and in your area. For your gift of $10, you can receive a special edition of our current program on an audio CD, or for a gift of $20, we'll send you our programs on DVD videos. For either order, call the 800 number on your screen right now.